This is Gabfest Radio. I'm David Plotz, along with Emily Bazelon and John Dickerson at the 92nd Street Y Tribeca in New York, and this is the political Gabfest portion of the show. So this week, two teenage boys from Steubenville, Ohio, Trent Mays and Malik Richmond, 116, 117, were convicted of rape and sentenced to 1 year and 2 years in juvenile, what is
at
it called?
It's juvenile detention.
For their abuse, their rape of an unconscious teenage girl at a party. The boys had stripped her, fingered her, tried to get her to give them oral sex, which she was too drunk to do, bragged about having sex with her, driven her around naked, and posed her for photos. Other boys photographed this. They tweeted about it. They posted videos to YouTube about it. The boys who were stars on the high school football team tried to sort of prevent anything from coming out about it. The adults in the community seemed to protect them for a while with the notion that because they were football stars, this was something that shouldn't blow up. But it did. There was a prosecution. These boys were now convicted. Emily, these boys were convicted of rape. Was that a fair conviction?
Yeah, I think it was. A couple really interesting, important things about this case. Social media played this really important role because the boys or somebody videotaped part of what was going on and also made a really ugly videotape kind of bragging about what had happened afterward. And a local blogger who felt that like this was being covered up posted these tapes and got the attention of the hacker collective Anonymous. And Anonymous started really going after some of these kids and unmasking their identities. And that the prosecution actually the kids were charged, I think, 10 or 11 days after the rape took place. But there's no question that really pushed everything forward. And to me, what's heartening about this is sometimes you see a picture from the evidence on social media that turns out to be really misleading. So you'll see one little piece of evidence that then turns out, if you knew the context, didn't really represent the story. In this case, it seems like this video was incredibly important and that without it, we wouldn't have had a prosecution and that it was, you know, just crucial evidence. So that was really heartening, I think. And then the other part of the story that I think matters is that in the end, this cover-up didn't happen. And the community is very divided over the wisdom of this prosecution. And there were girls, I think mostly girls, who after the convictions were tweeting in an outraged way at the victim and at anyone who'd gone after her. But, you know, the criminal justice system really did prevail and appropriately punish these boys.
So, Emily, the first question that came to my mind thinking about this case is, why is it that boys who are tweeting things, taking photographs, posting photographs to YouTube about most grotesque, and I'm surely they know, at least if not criminal, like totally immoral behavior, why did they think
that they were going to get away with it? So, you know, I get this question all the time about crazy cyberbullying shit that goes on online. And I think the answer is that 99% of the time, nobody is paying attention. Kids post all kinds of stuff, and they're usually all of it stays internal to their own network. And in their world, which in this case turned out to be a world of totally upside down morality and behavior, it's cool. And they're playing off of the social power they're getting from this, and it doesn't occur to them. And I also think, in all fairness to this 16 and 17 year old, we know that adolescents' brains are less developed and that the part that they're not as far along on is impulse control. So I think you're seeing that play out. And then the other thing we know about adolescents is they're neurologically the most susceptible to peer pressure in the sense that they take more risks in front of other kids. And it seems like this is just the example of that, where these boys behaved absolutely outrageously in this context where they were all performing, I think, in front of each other and in front of a larger audience, because there are all these other kids who may have witnessed some part of what was going on who, you know, there may be more prosecutions that come out of this.
So how legally did they take into account that fact that you obviously, that the brains of the people participating in this are not normal brains?
So in I think the right way, which is to say these kids were tried as juveniles in juvenile court and they were sentenced as juveniles. They could have been, and a lot of states would have been, prosecuted as adults. In that case, you're talking about far harsher punishment. And I think that is really, keeping them in the juvenile system was a really key move that was made. And so, you know, they may actually end up staying in juvenile detention until the age of 21, which would be a few years from now. But we're not talking about, you know, 10 to 20 year sentences that you might very well have had in adult court.
You know, two things struck me about this. One is your point about they assume that no one was watching. I think one of the reasons why they assume no one was watching is that the community, it's very important to focus on what this community was. If you look at Steubenville, Ohio, it is, according to census records, it's had the sharpest decline in population of any metropolitan area in the country over the past several decades. It is a place of pure decline. It has become, you know, a disastrous sort of wasteland. And I assume that to grow up there is to grow up in a place where people don't have jobs, where there isn't a lot of, there's not a lot of sense that anything you do matters or that anyone is paying attention to you. It's a place of, on the edge of civilization. Civilization has almost left it behind.
I was just going to say, just to interject, I was in Steubenville during the primaries because Rick Santorum had his...
As I said, civilization has left it behind.
Rick Santorum had his election night, the night of the Ohio primary, had it in Steubenville because he was appealing to those blue-collar steel towns that had died, which is why the social media piece of this is interesting, is you've got a town suffering under the death of the Industrial Revolution in the town, and yet social media, the sort of front edge of the
Silicon Valley way has come to them as well.
Right, and what I wondered from you, not to interrupt David's line of questioning, or maybe actually indeed to interrupt David's line of questioning, was how do you, you know, on one hand, if it weren't for social media, they probably wouldn't have gotten these two boys. On the other hand, the social media amplifies the crime, which was horrible enough just alone with no one who knows, but you know, part of it obviously is this was broadcast.
Right, and that disgrace, if that's the right word for it, leaves the girl who was the victim, she can't take those pictures and videos back, and that will always be part of her life. And I think that is why in this case I felt fine about the child pornography charge that was also brought. So one of the boys who sent the video out widely was also charged with distributing child porn. And usually I get very nervous when kids are charged with that offense because it just seems like an offense that wasn't created for teenage sexting. However, when you have a boy take a video that's this humiliating and base and then send it out widely to humiliate the girl who's in it, it just seems to me like that's indefensible. And, you know, again, I'm glad he was charged in juvenile court, but I'm also glad that other kids are going to see that this is just something you can get in really big trouble for, because somehow, as you were saying, David, the boys didn't get that.
Well, and neither did all the bystanders.
Right, nor did the bystanders, or else also the bystanders had typical...
To be fair, they may have been drunk out of their mind.
You know, yeah, I mean, which gets to a point, the other point I wanted to make, which is the thing that actually struck me most about this is how rare this is. Given what we know about teenage boys, I was a teenage boy once, John was a teenage boy once, you know, I think I speak from experience. Emily, you've experienced what teenage boys are like. Teenage boys are monsters, right? And they are drunk on testosterone all the time. They're barely able to control themselves in the best of circumstances. And it's a kind of tribute to the amazing power of
civilization.
Of law and civilization. No, that this doesn't happen.
Well,
this
of course it happens all the time. It's just it doesn't get put on.
Well,
I mean, people behave like cretins. They just don't. They don't take that extra step.
I don't
of
think this
either.
Happens all the time in modern America. I think this is something that happens fairly rarely, and that's a tribute to the kind of social controls we've got on people. Because I do think, in their natural state, basically this is what boys do. They behave in packs. They consume.
I think it happens all the time. You're going way too far in condemning all these teenage boys. I mean, yes, there are times.
Have you read the Bible? This is what the Bible is. The Bible is all about this. This is this is what tribal life is like young men
right, that whole
initiating
book of judges,
themselves.
Rape after rape.
I mean, you were saying backstage, you were saying, oh, this is like Friday Night Lights, and I was thinking, it's Friday Night Lights gone awry, but that to me was always the lie about Friday Night Lights is that these are all just, these boys are just like so innocent and nothing really is happening. Actually, what happens when young men play football, when young men engage in kind of collective homosocial violence, is they become unmanageable. They are unmanageable. And
right,
it happens.
But so but why is it more plausible that it's not happening, given everything you just said? Why is that more plausible than what I think is likely, which is that's happening, it's just not being tweeted about? That it's just people, they aren't, either they delete them, or they're just too stupid, or they're too drunk to get their iPhones out, and they're just behaving like this all over the place, all the time.
Well, because I think they do get their, my other sense is that everyone has their iPhones out all the time, and so they probably are tweeting about it. And you know the answer to this better than we do, Emily. Is this actually happening in every town every weekend? This is, Friday night is rape night. Or is it not? I mean, is this something that happens just very rarely?
I mean, I am skeptical about the sort of this is happening all the time epidemic idea that both of you are putting out there. I think there is a lot of really ugly tweeting and Facebook posting going on. I think that there is some actual sexual assault happening, yes. I would like to think, and I feel somewhat confident, that the idea of real group, that joint rape or whatever happened here exactly, plus a lot of group bystanding to this degree, is not terribly common.
But there honestly, was that situation in Connecticut.
In Torrington, Connecticut, in my fair state, there is a similar set of allegations unfolding, and for sure this does happen. And there's a fabulous book about this called Our Guys that, you know, is about exactly this phenomenon. So it's not as if this doesn't happen. We're having, you know, and also we know that most sexual assault is not reported, and that's especially true for teenagers. So certainly we can all agree that it's more common than we'd like. Can I change the subject slightly? So another thing, I know this is a very grim case, but there was another aspect of legally speaking that I actually found heartening, which was that this girl said and testified that she was essentially unconscious and didn't remember what had happened to her. And the defense went after her by saying, well, she was conscious enough afterward to text someone the password to her phone, and also put on this whole defense from other kids in the town that she was a liar. And I, as I watched that testimony unfold, thought she was sunk, that this idea that she was asleep was going to be enough to have people find reasonable doubt, to have this judge think that she had consented, or at least it wasn't clear she hadn't consented. And none of that happened. We didn't have a whole fight over whether, you know, if you're asleep, you've really consented. There was just sort of this general agreement that actually you have to actively consent to sex for it to be consensual. And that seemed really positive and heartening to me.
Right. Although a lot of the backlash against her.
Yes.
But
the backlash has been horrible. And I have to say, as someone who generally is like trying to argue that, you know, teenage behavior is complex and that we shouldn't just go around condemning people, the tweeting and posting that some of these kids have been putting out, I mean, after the trial, just utterly condemning her, it's impossible to defend. I mean, it's really, and it's true about the Torrington tweets and posts I've been reading too. I've kind of given up feeling in any way like we're supposed to understand this. It's really hard to understand.
All right, let's wrap that topic. So now's the moment in our show where we hear from our second sponsor, which is Stamps.com. A quick trip to the post office, hardly ever quick, driving there, finding parking, what a hassle. So use Stamps.com instead. Stamps.com is a quick and easy way to get postage on demand for any business. You can buy and print official US postage for any letter or package using your own computer and printer. Stamps.com will even send you a digital scale that calculates the exact postage you need for any class of mail. And one of our guests tonight, Mo, was telling me he actually used Stamps.com in a way that was new to me, which is that you can actually print stamps of yourself on Stamps.com. So if you feel like you deserve a stamp of your own, it sounds like you should be a Stamps subscriber. You don't need one of those expensive postage meters, and you'll never waste valuable time making trips to the post office again, and you will have your face on a stamp. So right now, use our promo code GABFEST, and you'll get a special offer, no risk trial. plus a $110 bonus offer, which includes the digital scale and up to $55 in free postage. You know what? I wonder if someone will make stamps of us. That would be awesome. Maybe someone will do that.
Can I say you're the only one of the three of us who would have that thought? That would never cross my mind.
You're fishing, and that was the lamest fishing ever.
I wonder if they'll make a stamp about us. Yay!
You know, you can make a
stamp.
You could stick. You could make a stamp of yourself and then mail it to yourself.
Oh my God!
For all the details of the special offer, to sign up, go to stamps.com. Before you do anything else, click on the microphone at the top of the homepage and type in Gabfest. Stamps.com, enter sad Gabfest.
We have to say something really nice to David organically before the end of the show to make up for that, because we're kind of ganging up on him and I feel bad.
You always say that you're ganging. I don't
know.
This
is the perfect segue into
segue
Lean In.
To Lean True. In, there we go. This week, Lean In, the new book by Facebook COO Sheryl Sandberg, will hit bestseller lists, I presume. It is the talked about book of the month, the year maybe. And Emily, tell us what Lean In argues.
Lean In is Sheryl Sandberg's kind of new feminist mantra. She says that she's a feminist. She has decided to really throw herself into the idea of trying to help women succeed in the workplace and especially in businesses. She has been obviously incredibly successful herself, and she has a number of really useful strategies and tips to share along the way. And essentially the way she frames the debate is that women have a lot of their own internal barriers that are keeping them from advancing the way they should, that they're holding themselves back. So this is a book that, rather than focusing on structural barriers erected by employers or legal barriers, is really about women's own internal psychology. And that's, I think, both its strength and its weakness.
So in the book, one of the things it argues is that women, because they are more communal, don't negotiate and aren't put out for themselves. One of the lines is, women are paying a professional penalty for their presumed desire to be communal, which is what you were just being, which is communal, we must all, the pod must embrace.
Emily was using we and not I.
And right. And that
I was using
that
I.
The community must be repaired after the boorish, horrible behavior by one of its members. And
two. I was in on that one.
Oh, see, again, you should put it all on me. Lean in. Lean in.
But you could argue that I was being totally self-promotional because David's our boss, and so I was actually out for myself and manipulating.
Conniving, manipulative. Yeah. Oh, but that's also in the book, that women who assert themselves are conniving and manipulative.
Are seen as conniving and manipulative, right? It's very hard to be super powerful and successful as a woman in the workplace without being labeled a bitch, essentially.
Right.
Thus, Sheryl Sandberg insulates herself.
He took no offense at the, if I may speak for you, at the little act of bullying, because he's a man.
Well, also because that's the way the show goes, right? If
do
David
not penetrate the fourth
offense,
wall.
We're in
don't
really
penetrate
big trouble.
The fourth wall.
We've got
a phony baloney thing going on here.
No, but I just meant that fine. I mean, if David started taking offense, that would change everything about Slate. We'd all be
right,
in really big
true.
Trouble.
I'm here. I'm sitting here. I'm here.
Who would we make fun of? We'd be lost.
All right, let's get back to Sheryl Sandberg and her book. So John mentioned the negotiation. What else are we supposed to lean in? How are we supposed to be leaning in?
Well, one of my favorite pieces of advice is this idea, don't leave before you leave. So in other words, Sandberg was seeing young women anticipating getting pregnant, wanting time off to have kids, and so not going after the promotion that would precede that would then give them a job they were really excited about to come back to. And I agree with her. I think that is something that really happens to young women in the workplace. I remember wrestling with that myself. I also think, though, and this is the weakness part, that she leaves out all the structural reasons why that happens. And one of our former colleagues, Jessica Gross, wrote, I thought, a really trenchant post about how when she was in exactly this position, she took a promotion and then she got incredibly sick during her pregnancy. And it turned out disability law didn't really cover. She needed basically months off to cope with being incredibly nauseous. And there was no way for her to get that. And so she said, hey, I leaned in and it completely backfired on me. So what about that problem?
But isn't Sandberg's point, though, that leaning in requires also a structure around it, and that everybody else, including employment law, employers, everybody else has to kind of buy into that.
She says
she's a feminist, she wants all the feminist gains that have happened, but when she comes to specifics about what it is that she is doing to structurally change the world or how the structural changes she promotes, this is where the book fails miserably.
She cites
one example, a single example of something she accomplished as a woman leader to make life better, which is when she was pregnant, she persuaded Sergey or Larry or Lurgay or Sergey to put in parking spaces for pregnant women who work at Google. That, and she cites that example 3 or 4 or 5 times in the book as like, this is the accomplishment. I mean, that's a pretty, first of all, you're a very high up executive. If you can't get pregnancy parking spots like done at Google, you really are not getting anything done. But if that's the only thing you can cite as something that's helping women, that's pretty weak.
Right. And then
everything else is the individual anecdotal. Well, like, let me help one woman at a time.
And a lot of
but isn't that also part of her message, is that women have to help women one woman at a time?
Right, but you can argue that there is something really just unhelpful about letting all these employers off the hook for bigger structural improvements. And this is also true about the campaign she launched in connection with the book. There are all these lean in circles she wants to start, and this is either the kind of new version of consciousness raising in the 1970s or a big tactics seller book. Whichever it is, companies can sign up and have these circles without doing one single thing that would actually help some pregnant or childbearing or just women generally be able to succeed.
I think her argument is that if she puts this framework out there, if she kind of highlights the idea and the ways in which women are, you know, there's this study between, what is it, Heidi and Howard, where the business school students studied basically the same person, one named Heidi, one named Howard. Howard is admired. Heidi is seen as kind of pushy. And if that story is told, then CEOs will start to think, you know, that evaluation I did where I thought the woman was maybe a little too aggressive, let me rethink that. And so the consciousness raising in that regard does change, presumably, if it's a CEO, he's affecting lots of other people.
Oh, I think that's exactly the defense, is that she is relying essentially on kind of behavioral economics tactics, right? These nudges, this idea that you'll wake up male CEOs to all the talent they're missing out on, and that will enact change internally. And that's the thing about that kind of change, though, it's very painless for companies, right? It's all about what's to their advantage in terms of advancing individual female employees, as opposed to thinking about paid parental leave, you know, restructuring the workplace.
And her category, her group of people that she's dealing with are basically corporate executives. It's hard to see how the lessons of lean in apply if you're a greeter at Walmart. I don't really get that. I mean, do they apply if you're a greeter at Walmart?
I mean, I think probably not, although I think that to give Sandberg credit, she is very clear about where she's situated in the conversation, and I don't think she overclaims about the relevance of her message, and that's important.
Can I just make one point, which is that I think there's a category error, which is that this book reflects all that is wrong with Facebook, in that Facebook has this notion that the personal... that like personal things at a very small level change the world. And they don't. Personal things at a very small level like make life nice. But personal things at a very small level do not, in fact, when you add them up without massive institutional changes, make huge differences. And I think that this book is all about like, oh, if small personal things happen, the whole world becomes a better place. And I'm not sure that's true. I think it requires bigger social movements.
Right, go ahead.
But isn't she trying to start a bigger social movement? And isn't the smaller things the sort of the smoking and seatbelt example, where you, Bloomberg aside, where you have a generation of people who are habituated to a new way of thinking about smoking, and they say to their parents, don't smoke.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. No. I. Yeah. Right. I think so.
Can I just say what? Can I say?
Go ahead. No.
Oh,
you're afraid to interrupt me in this part of the show.
I know. I don't know whether I'm being communal or a jerk. Both. So my reaction after reading this book is that I am a woman. So here's the problem. She talks about She talks about the fraud complex, the idea that basically someday you're going to be discovered.
You totally do have that.
Yes.
We do. Lots of us
so
do.
So there's that. Then there's the...
Explain what the fraud
complex is. So the fraud complex is, and I think she quotes Tina Fey basically saying, the idea is that no matter how successful you get, you basically figure out that any minute now somebody's going to come along and go like, you've been discovered. You're actually a total fraud, and that then that's it. Your whole the whole ball of wax is over, and you're you know, I don't know what you're doing, but you're not doing whatever it was you were doing before. And so there's the fraud complex. There's the under negotiating. The idea in the book is that men are basically ruthless and go in there and get everything they want in negotiations. And that like if that were me,
I love that about you.
Yeah. So there's that.
And actually, you are a total communal thinker, too.
And then the last one is the... she says in the book that Arianna Huffington said that women have to learn to take criticism. So when I came over to Slate from Time, you know, and I was... It was kind of the change in the internet as well, but, you know, I was open... You know, Time, you write a thing, and it goes out there into the world, and maybe somebody reads it in a doctor's office somewhere, but you are...
There's a nice, sedate letter to the editor.
You are insulated. There are huge institutional barriers that keep the hordes at bay. And so, you know, I came to Slate, and like, you know, it's still constant and true. I mean, the criticism from, you know, commenters, well, like, it's so strong, it'll part your hair. And so learning to do that is something that she in the book talks about as being something only women have to get used to.
Well, isn't this the problem, though, with being too essentialist in these arguments? I mean, lots of people are at 55% on these spectrums. And yes, more women are probably, but we always get confused we make these categories very binary and definite in a way that they're not. And you're right, you do have all those traits. That's one of the reasons... It's- Right?
But and wait, don't interrupt her. She was about to say that's one of the reasons.
We love you.
Yeah. You know, you did that just as well as we did it in rehearsal.
But on the other hand, I think, you know, of course you're not. That doesn't suddenly mean you have a female mind. There's something kind of crazy about that.
That was... I love the idea that you're a woman, John. That is.
Why? Now what are you going to do? Give him a pay cut? Yeah. That is going to be nice of
these two. Jeez.
I will say,
it to him, sister.
Are you going to burn that bra later, Yorin? So, I will say, as a boss, that one of the shocking things that I find is that almost no women who work for me ever ask for raises. It is really...
David?
No, it's I don't really understand why that is.
Huh.
There are a few who do. Whenever they do, I think that is great. I love that.
And then he says no.
I know, and then, right.
Huh. So what I notice as an editor, and I've noticed this for a long time, I get lots of freelance pitches that come in, and men are more likely to be willing to riff on an idea that they don't really know what they're talking about, right?
And so we decided to found a magazine on that principle.
Right. And most of the writers remain men. Right. No, I really do notice that when I ask someone to write something, a law professor, if it's a woman, she'll much likely say, oh, I need a whole week, impossible. Or, oh, well, I'm not an expert on that. And there are men who do that, but usually they just say, oh, yeah, sure, when, you know, an hour? Yeah, I'm done. I'm there. Maybe I just ask men who know more. Maybe I'm a bad, but I don't think so. I think there's something else going on.
All right, have we lent in?
We leaned.
Lent?
Well, yeah. It is the season of Lent, but I don't think only for my people.
So let's turn to cocktail chatter, the one thing that when you've had more beers at a cocktail hour than you should have before a show that you will be chattering about. John.
Oh, wait, I have to load it here.
Do you want me to go
first? You know, my parking's expired. Yeah, you go first because I can't find it.
Okay.
Emily.
I'll go first. Mine is super geeky. So one of my favorite Supreme Court cases this term came, the opinion came down this week. It's about a Thai student who was at Cornell and then went on to grad school. And part of the way he paid for his education was by reselling his textbooks in Thailand. And he made over $100,000 in profits by doing this because he could buy them here and then sell them in Thailand. When the publisher, John Wiley, figured out he was doing this, they sued. And John Wiley won at the appeals court, got $600,000 in damages. And the idea was that he'd broken the Copyright Act, the Federal Copyright Act, by reselling these textbooks without permission at a lower price in Thailand. This kind of gray market selling. So I thought that this Thai student was going to lose at the Supreme Court, but he won. He won 6-3, very strange breakdown, left-right justices on both sides. And the argument is that under what's called the first sale doctrine, once a copyright owner, John Wiley publisher, sells something, other people can resell it forever. This is how libraries and used booksellers work. And it doesn't matter. There's no geographic limitation, Justice Breyer said, for the court. So this right of resale applied to this Thai student in the same way that it would. It didn't matter that he was abroad. He still had the same right. And the dissent argued vociferously that this is a crazy result, that it's going to be bad for producing creative works in the United States, and that this whole threat to libraries, which was a big issue for the majority, is like a made-up threat because there hasn't really been any litigation. But at this point, basically, we have kind of this big free market for reselling American copyrighted works abroad, and the only change would be if Congress rewrites the statute.
Can I ask you a question about...
See? It's okay. David said he was going to have to feign interest in this earlier. He made me stop talking about it earlier so he would only have to feign interest once.
Now, wait.
It's true.
I'm going to participate. I'm going to... No, he meant that he didn't want you to leave it in the locker room.
No, he didn't.
I'm trying to protect the community.
JD, what's your
Can topic? I just wait? Can I ask you one question about dissents that argue vociferously? Do dissents ever argue in any other fashion? Do they ever just say like, "Man, well, yeah, man, we don't like it, but yeah, it's pretty good, but no, we don't like
yeah,
it."
Yeah, there's like different tones of dissents.
Yeah.
And I'm not even sure this counted as vociferous actually because Justice Ginsburg wrote it, and she's always careful to say that she respectfully dissents.
Well, yeah, okay. So my chatter is about this great experiment where they took freestyle rappers and they put them in an MRI and they basically discovered that while they're free rapping, that they basically there's a part of the brain that shuts down the prefrontal cortex and basically allows you to stop self-editing yourself. And so as a writer, that really would be a really helpful thing to have. And they
I feel
also
like the show sometimes has that.
That the prefrontal cortex is shut the hell down, yeah. Yeah, well, this may be why. Anyway, they also found this is true of jazz musicians when they're riffing and they're collaborating in real time, that basically the brain changes, and that they now can duplicate this phenomenon in regular people who are neither free rappers nor jazz musicians by basically shooting electrodes into the brain. And so I'm thinking that surely soon they'll have like a thing you can wear on your hip pocket. And when you've got writer's block, or you're not being sufficiently creative. And so they did this, by the way, in a laboratory.
Is that
called
Ritalin, that thing?
No, I don't think so. I don't think that, I don't think it's that. I think it's when they basically did this experiment where people were given a set of problems, and when they were then zapped, they were more creative in their approach to problem solving and were more successful when they got into that mode. So I don't know, this may be a growth opportunity for us or something, but...
So I don't even want to do a chatter tonight. So I'm gonna turn my chatter over. You, sir, I'd like you to come do a chatter for us. So.
I don't necessarily.
So what's. What's your name, sir?
Is this on?
Yeah, don't be nervous. I know it's like there's a crowd.
I'm actually
out
very
here.
Actually I'm very
don't
nervous.
Be,
I'm much more nervous
anxious.
Than I thought I would be.
He's our original drummer.
Thank you very much. They dropped me for Pete Best.
What's your chatter, Stephen?
My name is Stephen Colbert, and I'm a huge fan. And these guys have been very nice. They've asked me to stop by for years, but I have shows, my stupid show, most of the nights that you guys are in town. But this is the first night that you've been here, and my show's been dark, and so I'm so happy to be here. Because I listen every week. Not only do I listen every week to this Gabfest, I go back and listen to old ones. Like, I was just listening to you guys wondering what Rick Perry would mean to the race. David, you take more risks than Emily or John do.
We don't like to predict.
Thank you.
You really do.
What did I say, Rick Perry? He was going to be President Perry.
You were actually asking, like, what does this mean, John? And John said he could very well blow up on the launch pad.
You're lying.
No, you said these are all the reasons why he's great, but who knows?
Oh, yeah.
There's plenty of reasons for him to blow up on the launch pad. That's why you don't take risks.
Yeah, yeah.
You were like, you know, I'm a huge Lord of the Rings fan. Yeah. And in Lord of the Rings, I think it's Gildor is this elf who says to Frodo, "Ask not advice of the elves; they will tell you both yes and no." You are so elvish.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, I'm happy to be here, and thank you for having me, and I'm thrilled. I have a chatter. And that is about Richard Nixon, who is my president, because I'm older than all of you, I think. Who's the eldest of you guys?
John, by a little bit.
44.
I'm 48. Okay, I'm 48. So I'm just old enough to remember Nixon as actually being president, like actively and seeing speeches and that kind of stuff. And Watergate is very vivid to me because it interrupted the Munsters in the afternoon when I came home.
Very similar, I thought.
Yeah, extremely. Similar hairlines between Grandpa and Richard Nixon.
Right.
But I was fascinated with Nixon as a child, and I'm the youngest of 11 children, so my older brothers and sisters would explain to me, especially my sister Margot, would explain to me why Watergate was important. Why it was important that I couldn't watch the Beverly Hillbillies. Instead, I had to watch Senator Sam Ervin with the giant eyebrows, being just a country lawyer asking for answers. And so I despair that people forget Nixon's crimes. And I don't mean just Watergate, which is, while it's you know, it's got a sexiness to it and bugging and that kind of stuff, is that like the war crimes of Nixon. I despair that people forget those, especially now with the 10th anniversary of the Iraq War, you know, having come and gone. Well, it was just the my chatter is about LBJ's library has released tapes that the BBC has done condensations of that say that. While it was suspected for a long time that Nixon had helped prolong the Vietnam War in order to win against Humphrey in 68, the LBJ tapes say no, that was true. LBJ had been bugging ambassadors' phones in the lead up to the peace talks with South and North Vietnam, and that LBJ is heard saying, "Our friend in California, the Republican nominee, seems to be working on both sides of North and the South to keep these peace talks from happening," and says in the recordings, "Well, you know, this is probably treason, but I'm not going to tell anybody because then they'd find out I'm bugging the ambassador." But he tells Humphrey, and Humphrey says, "No need, I've got this one." And Nixon did it for political advantage because he said to the South Vietnamese, "I'll give you a better deal." And part of his campaign was, the old peace with honor is, "I'll get you a better deal." And he was able to use the mishandling of the Democrats' mishandling of the war as his victorious campaign. Now, of course, this led to the deaths of tens of thousands of people, shattered the trust of the American people to the American military establishment, to trusting the president. And change your relationship to the president forever. And the depth of his selfish evil mustn't be forgotten. Because while he's not the only one, he's the for me.
Yeah.
And the for the American people, because he's the first one who had truly the adversarial relationship with the press, a press that was happy to engage in that adversarial relationship. Now, we just had the 10th anniversary of the Iraq War. A bare minimum of the American people think it was a bad idea now. You know, we've only been out 18 months totally. You know, officially military actions ended 3 years ago, or August 3 years ago, something like that. 40 years on, a majority of people 18 to 34 think that Vietnam was the right thing.
They do?
Yes.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah.
That was, you buried your lead there.
That's so I may be misquoting that. It may be younger, might be 18 to 24, but I'm shocked by both of those things. And so that's my chatter, and that's why I like it.
I lied and said I have a chatter, and I didn't want to give it up to him. So I actually want to do my chatter.
I was so afraid it was going to be my chatter.
No.
Because backstage I said, what's everybody's chatter? And he said, we're not going to tell you.
Yeah. No, so as some of you may know, I'm really interested in pandas. I'm obsessed with pandas. And so the ultimate panda story crossed my desk this week. Some of you may have seen me asking a little bit about it on the Facebook page. It wasn't the panda, the people who dress up as pandas and film themselves having sex. That was not it. But it's almost worse, which is that researchers in China, I'm not paying attention to this. Researchers in China, how is it? Is it cool?
Yeah. It's good. It's doing it.
Researchers in China are now, because the pandas are so unwilling to mate, they are now showing panda porn to the pandas. The panda females are in heat 36 hours a year, which is less than boys in Steubenville are in heat in a day. And they're just not interested. The panda males aren't interested. No one's interested. And it just, I think we can basically say an animal has reached an evolutionary dead end when it will not have sex to reproduce itself. And when it's only decides, the only time it can have sex is for Wednesday afternoon and Thursday in March, and that's it. And so I think we can basically stick a nail in the panda coffin at this point.
So you know
oh, yeah.
Yeah. But the thing is, you said no one is interested. Clearly you are interested.
I just think there's a huge amount of money that is spent on these stupid pandas, which would be so much better spent trying to save an animal that wants to be saved.
To properly hate pandas, you have to learn a lot about them. You're like, hate watching
pandas.
Can
I just as a kind of technical thing, is the porn that they're watching human porn, panda porn, or these people who dress up like pandas? And
porn. They did find a couple of pandas, I guess, who were willing to have sex, and they filmed them, and
yeah,
now they show
it. It's all from like the
70s. Yeah,
but do the pandas pay attention?
Yeah, apparently the one female panda paid attention a little bit. She like was a little bit interested. Yeah.
Mostly though in the clothing.
Did it work? Did it work?
I think it's another problem with the pandas that their gestation period is like, you know, a really long time, so I don't think this just happened. So I don't think they're not sure yet.
Clearly, we're going to need an update on
this. We'll get an update.
Was this straight, very straight panda sex?
Yeah.
Or was this daring? Was this role playing? Like you be an ocelot and I'll be.
Do you think maybe
a chimp?
Maybe they dress up like people. Do you think there's some pandas that dress up like people?
Oh yeah. They get, by the way, I checked my stats. It's not a majority of the American young people. It's only 57% of all Americans thinks Vietnam was a mistake.
I see. That's a little better.
I wonder what the highest of that was. What was it at its highest?
In 2000, it was 2000 was 62%.
Ah, so right in the middle of the Iraq War, right? Yeah.
No. Iraq War 2003.
Over.
I didn't mean
but
for my Vietnam
moment...
thing to bring your panda porn down.
No.
I thought panda porn was over, and I didn't know.
What you have that we lack is a sense of timing.
All right, we'll close the show, then we'll do a Q&A. Stephen, stay up for 1 minute on the Q&A. You get the first question. How about that?
I don't think that's appropriate, but thank you.
Okay. All right, so we're going to do we'll do a radio close. That'll do it for the political gap. Yeah, let me try that again. That'll do it for the political Gabfest portion of the show. Thanks to our terrific audience at 92nd Street Y Tribeca. And to Jordan Abel and her team for their help, I'm David Plotz in New York. The Culture Gabfest starts right now. All right, now we're going to do the close for our show, if I can find it. Okay. You'll find links to some of the things we talked about today, including panda porn, at our show page, slate.com/gabfest. You can email us at gabfest@slate.com or comment at our Facebook page, facebook.com/gabfest. Please subscribe to our podcast on iTunes, which helps other people discover the show. You can find it by searching for Slate Political Gabfest in the iTunes store. Don't forget to leave a comment while you're there. Our producer is Mike Vuolo. Thank you, Mike. Our intern is Jeff Friedrich. The executive producer for Slate Podcast is Annie Bowers. Aaron Bergen organized the living daylights out of this show tonight. Thank you, Aaron. Our Twitter feed is @SlateGabFest. You should follow it. Thank you to Jordan Abel and the staff of the 92nd Street Y Tribeca for their hospitality. And please join Slate here again on April 21st for a first, the inaugural Dear Prudence live show with the incomparable Emily Yaffe offering advice on really awesome, crazy, weird things. For Emily Bazelon and John Dickerson and Stephen Colbert a little bit too, I'm David Plotz. We'll talk to you next week.
Thanks, that was fun.
Do you want a question?
I'll do one.
All right, there's a microphone here, so please come up for questions. And whoever was sitting over there who kindly gave up their seat, yeah, he's got his question, good. Stephen,
well, the first person in line may not be for me because they've been lining up for a while. I was right.
Well done.
I'll just sit down.
No, do a question, then sit down, okay. And then we'll be fine.
So I guess I'll ask for all of you. What's it like to be together on stage?
It's fantastic.
Yeah.
It's really great. I look forward to it every week. I actually kind of do because I listen every week. And I'm so excited to be the fourth person at this little table where you guys are having lunch and I'm invited, or breakfast, because I listen to you guys in the morning on Fridays. And if it's not on time, I'll write David and go, what is going on? I've got a production meeting at 10:30 and I need to know something about politics.
Yeah, the reason we found out that Stephen was a fan is that I got a call in my office one afternoon from him.
Oh,
and okay. I thought it was just someone pranking me. But he's saying, like, why is the show
it's
not up?
It's 3 o'clock. Why is the show not up, David Plotz?
And then David, so
now I got a warning. Now if it's going to be posted later, I get an email from David saying, it was live last night, we went out drinking, it's going to be up a little bit later than we thought it was going to be. But this, now I'm going to like the live ones more, now that I've done it. Yeah, because I really enjoyed the live show being here. And I will now enjoy them more because I always felt it was like somebody else was with my friends when I would hear the live show. I'd hear you people laughing and I'd go, what are those people doing with my, you must have felt the same way. What are those people doing with my friends? And so I'd listen to them, but it was like, mm. And because you're playing to a different crowd. And but now it'll feel just as intimate to me. So thank you for having me.
Thank you. All right. So we have a new rule for live podcasts, which is everything has to happen in a minute. Your question and our answer is a minute. And that will allow us to get to all these questions. And that's what we're going to do. Everyone who's lined up, you'll get a question, but it's going to be 1 minute.
Do we have our...
Do we have a timer? Jeff, do you have a timer by any chance?
I have a timer, sure.
Okay, bring it.
But never mind.
All right.
So quick follow-up question about Rob Portman. He came out in favor of his son, who is gay and gay rights, last week. Where does he fit in the new Republican Party? And does that depend on what the Supreme Court says at the end of the term?
He is my new favorite Republican senator, and part of my reason for optimism about the California gay marriage case, as well as the Defense of Marriage Act case, because he's part of actually a large group. Over 100 prominent Republicans have asked the court to strike down Proposition 8 and essentially begin to recognize
only
gay
he's the only
sitting
Republican legislator.
One other thing I'd add, since we're under time pressure, is in this GOP autopsy report, it says basically the only way you're going to get younger voters is, it says civil rights is their number one issue, and that it doesn't get any more specific, but what it means, of course, is same-sex marriage. And
things are changing, and he is a sign of that.
But Emily, do you think it's okay that the only, I mean, I think it's fine that he comes out because his son is gay. All right.
Hi, thank you for coming. So CPAC just happened. Why isn't there an LPAC?
There is.
LPAC would be liberal political action.
And
why
is it?
What is it?
There are Netroots and the Netroots Nation, the Daily
Coast. But it doesn't
Coast.
Have the same kind of enforcement
not as
quality.
Big. There
why
aren't
not?
As many liberals in the Democratic Party as there are conservatives in the Republican Party.
And they're better at flexing their political muscles.
Bigger, they're more, yeah, I mean.
More successful.
But this is why I think the Republican Party's current turmoil is interesting, because the Democratic Party is going to have its own conversation at the end of the, you know, or, well, in a couple of weeks, whenever Obama turns into and people start talking about 2016.
And actually, the Netroots has been, if you think about it, has been incredibly effective. I mean, why is the Obama team so well organized? It all comes out of the sort of that beginning in 2004, the Howard Dean movement. I mean, that organizational, that use of technology begins with the Netroots people. So I do think its influence, at least in sort of the tactics of the party, has been huge.
Yeah.
Wow, that was under a minute. Rock and roll.
Hi, thank you for being here. My question is, and it has to do with the recent sugary drinks ban, and I guess its predecessor, which would be the anti-smoking laws. And so my question is, what do you think is going to be the next social ill that we all try to solve as a society?
Good one.
Yeah, that's great.
We talked about this a little bit on our conundrum. Well, I was making the argument that it's consumption. It's overconsumption, and that's the next thing we're going to address.
I bet it's meat. Yes. But
you think it's meat.
Overconsumption is so broad. We already had this fight, but don't you think overconsumption is broad?
Right, but we could start tackling it. We could start talking. We could start with cars, or we could start with too many airplanes.
Wait, so what?
But meat.
So wait, what do your kids talk about that? Because they're usually the leading edge of all this stuff. Like, what are they hip to when they come home from school?
They eat a lot of
Carly Rae Jepsen.
My kids.
Yeah.
But they're obsessed with turning off the water and the lights.
Really? Yeah. I don't. Yeah.
I think it's meat. I do think it's meat because it's got a face.
That hasn't helped you with pandas, dude.
I will eat them. They're not delicious, actually. They apparently taste terrible.
You know too much.
You are a panda fetishist, is frankly what it comes down to.
Don't you know, like, the why I finally discovered? I'm sorry, I'm talking about this so much. But why I finally discovered why I'm obsessed with pandas. It took, like, a moment, a flash of psychological insight. I have no psychological insight about myself. But one day I was talking to someone about pandas, and they were saying, why are you so weirdly obsessed with pandas? And I realized that the pandas in the National Zoo. Yeah.
Get to finish your sentence rule for David?
No. I think let the performance moment be.
The pandas in the Washington National Zoo arrived in Washington in 1970, which is the year I was born and moved to Washington. Those pandas, and I was taken as a kid to see those stupid pandas in the zoo over and over and over again. And I think I felt about that. And then I moved back to Washington after college. And, I live in Washington, but I don't really have any love for Washington. I live there because my wife and children are there. My parents are there. And it's fine, but I think I felt myself to be a panda, kind of imprisoned, sadly, in this city that was alien to me. And it's an identification, it's a too close identification with pandas that has made me hate them.
I don't think you're right about any of that.
Right. So
hi, thanks so much.
And that concludes the David Plotz Therapy Hour.
Thanks so much for being here. My question is about bullying. Who do you think is the biggest bully in politics and why?
Oh, the biggest bully in politics. You know, let's see. I mean, I think Newt Gingrich held that title for a long time, right? Do you disagree?
I'm trying to think. What a category. Do they have to be an elected official? Can they be? Because there are lots of talk radio show hosts who are basically
bullies. Rush Limbaugh is a professional bully. I mean, you could argue. I'm trying to think who on the left plays that role successfully.
Colbert.
Who's the influencer?
But can you?
You called me a bully on my own damn show.
I did, and you cried.
Emily, as an ex, but can you be a bully when you're right?
Yeah, you're a bully.
That was an attempt to suck up to him. Come on, we need more participation from the community.
Yes, you can.
So,
Chris Matthews. That's
but who
a good
else?
Candidate.
But what about? Can we
Bill
just
Maher?
Find an elected official?
What's his name? Bill Maher. That's what I was going to say.
Elected official who's a bully.
Chuck Schumer has his.
I don't think so.
No.
Barney Frank
Cruz.
Was a bully.
Cruz
yeah.
Has a little
bully.
Good
major
choice.
Bully.
Good
yeah. Major
choice.
Bully.
Yes. Yeah, Barney Frank.
Good
Ted
choice.
Cruz has some bully in him.
Yes.
Huh?
Who?
I don't think. Because he didn't. No. He wasn't intellectually powerful enough to bully the way Frank is.
Bloomberg.
Could probably,
yeah.
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 Yeah. elements of it.
All right.
Great question.
That was a good question.
We'll put that on the Facebook page and have people submit ideas.
Yeah, but also you have to keep us honest on our terms, because it's like bully is not synonymous with person you don't like.
Repetition and power imbalance.
Yeah.
I had a question about redistricting. It seems like the way we currently do redistricting is at the heart of the Democrats not being able to get a hold of the House, and also at the heart of like why our politics is so dysfunctional in Washington. But it's not an issue for anyone, like, right, at all. Why is it there more push to be like California-style redistricting everywhere?
Right. It's only the people it's an issue for are the people who are currently in power in the state legislatures, and they, you know, organize it in a way that helps their party. So I don't know. You know, it's like filibuster reform. It's all these structural reforms that it's hard to get people exercised and interested in them. And I think it's also hard in a time when people are really, like, people are still suffering and struggling. And even if they have jobs, they are. The bruise from the last recession is still very, very tender. And, you know, people just want something that speaks to them, and structural, and
the word redistricting itself does not.
Yeah.
Right. And but there has been some progress state by state, right? California now we're starting to have more nonpartisan redistricting.
Hi. First off, my sister is a screenwriter and recently was asked to write a screenplay about pandas, and she asked me, she was told, "Oh, well, of course you like pandas. Who doesn't like pandas?" And I was like, there's this podcast. Also, my dad is a big fan, asked when you guys are going to combine Festivus from Seinfeld with the Gabfest. Side note. So my question's actually related to Obama's visit to Israel, and I've been hearing lately some commentary about how the Third Intifada, which a lot of people think is inevitable, actually might be the necessary component to lead both Israelis and Palestinians to feel like there's a mutually hurting stalemate and a time to actually, this is the impetus for actually negotiating. And on the other hand, it might actually be something that causes Israelis to actually retreat more into not wanting to negotiate. And I'm curious, in 1 minute, what you guys think about this.
Oh, I am feeling so bleak about the Israeli-Palestinian crisis right now. I don't know if I've ever felt as pessimistic. And that is because I'm so angry with this Israeli government for doing so many things that make it impossible, I think, for the Palestinians, the moderates, to really have power.
We basically talked about Steubenville because we wanted a cheery topic instead of Obama's. I mean, truly, like,
we had that discussion, yeah.
Thank you for coming. I had another follow-up about the gay marriage debate, and I know you've obviously had this conversation a number of times before, but I was wondering how the various public acceptance things that have come out in this week, if that's changed your thinking at all about whether the court will take into account the fact that such a big majority of Americans now agrees with same-sex marriage.
So one of the truisms I like about the Supreme Court is that they don't respond to the weather, but they do care about the climate, right? This sort of broader sense of how public opinion is moving. Justice Kennedy is the only vote, I think, that matters in these cases next week. He cares particularly about the climate, and I think it's huge for him. And I've become much more optimistic about the results. I was always optimistic about the Defense of Marriage Act case, and I'm talking now about a pro-gay rights, pro-gay marriage ruling. I feel much better about the California case in wake of this poll and all these Republicans who
right.
have been coming forward.
I mean, in that context, the Portman thing was headlines and was in the news cycle for 24 hours.
It makes
that
it
matters.
Mainstream, and all of that is good. Good, good, good.
Just a note, we're going to take all the people who are in line. You'll get to ask questions, but nobody join the line, please.
Thank you.
So your journey last week to talk about religion got me thinking more broadly about political philosophy. And I was just wondering, what in your view are the components of the good life? And do you think that our political and economic institutions are equipped to provide those components of the good life for most people?
Awesome question.
That's a great question.
Components of good life. Kindness and charity to others.
Middle class economic situation. And that's the part I'm worried about, is whether we have undercut our broad middle class and what we can do to bring it back.
Love and companionship. Community. I mean, I think connections to other people.
And do we foster that as a country?
No, not so well, no. A sense of share. I mean, I think you're part of something you're sharing with others, which we're become increasingly terrible at.
And polarized.
Although it's funny, this is kind of an example of a shared community that was created in part through technology in a way that people said atomized us, but actually
and Obama
clearly
wants to
hasn't.
Tax it out of existence.
From our left fielder.
So one of the things that was really horrible about the Steubenville case, I thought, was what the victim had to go through during the trial. Like, her friends testified against her, said she was a liar. They had a defense doctor who said she could have consented and then forgotten. They showed her a photo on the stand that she'd never seen before, and she broke down. And John mentioned that a lot of these things don't go to trial a lot of times. So you guys are usually pretty open-minded about changing big things in the legal system, like getting rid of the First Amendment. Is there a way to solve this problem, or is it just sort of impossible because you can't have a fair trial unless you relive the crime?
You know, there are some states that have sturdier rules about going after the victim on the stand. So different models about what kind of evidence you can bring in to impeach that person and make them fall apart, essentially. But I think it is an insoluble problem. And I actually think it's really important, even though it's horrible, to maintain this strong, if we're going to have an adversarial system, then people need to be able to go after the main witness on the stand. And I'm talking now about defense lawyers. And unfortunately, often in a sexual assault case, all you have is the victim. So to some degree, I don't think we can really fix the problem, even though it has really bad consequences because it makes a lot of women afraid to come forward.
Hi. Can you talk about the India rape case and Steubenville? I mean, they're both privileged class groups getting outed, you know, football players and males. And in India, maybe there's a paradigm shift going to happen because of what happened.
I mean, I hope you're right about that. So there have been a couple of really horrifying cases in India of rape. And I think some new attention to the degree to which that problem is something the police can't even begin to deal with because it's so prevalent and because there's so much resistance, or at least perceived resistance, for prosecuting men. So it seems to me like India is having a moment of truth and of really struggling with how endemic this is to the culture and how much it matters in terms of women's rights and women's ability to move freely around the country. And that's hugely important and really welcome.
And there's a new law, I guess, which has been introduced and seems like it will be likely to pass, which is a much stronger rape law. But I don't know much about this at all.
No, I think that's a sign of progress. And mostly, there's also just an incredible need to enforce the existing laws. And as a society, take seriously the problem of violence against women as a huge barrier to women's progress in India.
Thank you.
Hi, with the assault weapons dropping out of any gun bill, what's the quick take on the dynamics on the Democratic side within the Senate? And how is the White House viewing their level of engagement, either they just want any kind of bill to pass so they can say one was done, or do they want to shape the outcome within one?
Any bill.
Full background checks?
Called this one, you know.
Yeah, they always, assault weapons ban was always never going to be a part of this thing. It was always something that they put on there, and it'll still come up as an amendment so that everybody can say, if they need to, Democratic senators in those states in particular that have tough red state Democrats, they can say, I voted against the assault weapons ban, but I was for background checks. The key question is records. And this is what's very interesting, is how and where and who keeps the records. And that's where the real breakdown in this conversation is. And the key senators to watch are, well, Joe Manchin of West Virginia is basically the key, because he comes from, he has an A rating from the NRA. He's the one who's talking to the NRA and trying to say, basically, on whatever the final bill is, either stay neutral or be in favor of it. There's almost no way they'll be in favor of it. But if they can stay neutral on whatever the final bill is, and again, the key question is on record keeping, not just a background check, but then once the background check is done, do you keep a record of the person who made the purchase? That's the key thing to watch. I think the White House wants anything.
But Coburn is now saying you can't keep the records, right?
Yeah, Coburn's essentially saying is don't treat law-abiding citizens
as if
they're criminals. And his argument for that is largely a purely political one, which is basically they think records equals they're coming to take your guns. And you can argue with them all day long that it doesn't mean that,
right,
but that's what they believe.
They
and if that's the state of play, you're not going to get anything to pass if you include something
ridiculous
in there like this.
All right, our last question. You've waited very patiently.
Hi. I'd just like to preface by saying this is kind of the coolest night ever. This has been really awesome. So today is Twitter's 7th birthday, I believe. How has Twitter and social media transformed the art of political reporting?
John Dickerson.
John Dickerson, Twitter pioneer.
Well, you know, it's all Slate's. One of the beauties of coming to Slate was that I wanted to write in my own voice and be engaged in the process we're engaged in here, which is the excitement of politics, all of the ugly parts of politics and the good parts would be out there in the open, and we'd all have a big conversation about it. And Twitter allows that to happen. I think it got incredibly corrosive and is a lot more corrosive than it was when I first started doing this in 07. But the people that I know as a result of Twitter and the conversations I have with people on Twitter, and the things I can write that used to just get stuck in a notebook. And, you know, we're all in this business to basically see something we think is interesting and then go tell our friends. And our friends in this case is the rest of the world. And if you have a vehicle where you can say that little cool little thing that you saw or happened, the ability to then go and put that out there for people to enjoy and for them to learn something by is like basically the whole reason we get into doing this. And, or at least I did anyway. And so in that sense, it's a wonderful thing. And so I think on balance, and all of my colleagues in politics have learned how to do this really, really well. And it's a great thing for people who don't have yet a big voice in the game to nevertheless show and speak in their voice in a way that they can get followers, even if they're not allowed on TV by their networks because they're a producer or something else. It's been a great thing.
Thank you all so much. We'll see you soon. Emily, you're gonna sign books over there. Come say hello.